Joining me now for more on this is Mike Papantonio, America's lawyer and host of Ring of Fire Radio. Hey, Pap, welcome back.
Thom, how are you?
Great. This is really astounding. I mean, this looks like something out of East Germany. Or East Berlin. How did our police forces get weapons of war?
Well, what's happening in Ferguson, Thom, is just a snapshot of a new militarized police culture that's sweeping through small towns all over the South in a big way. Now, not just the South, but certainly the South in a big way. What we're seeing is the advent of the Dixieland Commando Police Force that at first appearance, it's almost humorous, almost like a Barney Fife kind of humor. If it wasn't so tragic, it might be funny. Militarized toys of war simply don't belong in the hands of police in a town with a population of 20,000 people, Thom. And the small town police forces shouldn't be encouraged to equip themselves or to play dress up in commando ninja outfits, arming themselves with Bearcat armor, tactical war vehicles or assault helicopters and 22-ton mine-resistant attack vehicles. But that's what's going on. Paramilitary equipped small town police have a way of taking a Ferguson kind of tragedy and escalating it into this cataclysmic quality of civil unrest and disaster for a lot of reasons. And the reasons are many. And most of it has to do with it. They're marginally trained, marginally qualified. They certainly to use an AK-47 or to use shock grenades or battering rams. And the problem is, Thom, when you give them a sledgehammer, people on the street always look like big nails to them, simply because they don't have the sophistication they need to handle this equipment.
To paraphrase the famous psychologist, there's an interesting couple of graphics over on Facebook at the Freethinkers United for Change group. The first is labeled Black Power, and it shows an African-American young man standing in front of five cops with holding submachine guns on him, and it says the inability to surrender to the police. And then the next one says white power, and it's a shot of the snipers at the Bundy Ranch, the militia guys up at the top. And it says white power, the ability to aim an assault rifle directly at a uniformed officer and not only not be arrested and not be immediately killed, but celebrated as a hero. Your thoughts on this vivid contrast?
You can't ignore the racial issues here. Look, you had the KKK, Thom, put together a reward fund for the officer who did the shooting. They said he was a hero for shooting Jewish-controlled black thugs. And so you can't ignore that. For this police department, by the way, here you have the chief of police, who there's a photograph kicking around where there's a Confederate flag hanging in his home. Thom, what's important to me is Obama has to get involved here. He can't just give this speech and act like that's a minor issue. You remember when Robert F. Kennedy was in Indianapolis on the day that Martin Luther King was assassinated. He was in the inner city, one of the most hotbed for racial unrest. He shows up there. He'd written this speech on the back of an envelope. No time to prepare. Stands up in the back of a flatbed. In Indianapolis, in that city, was one of the only major cities in the country where there wasn't civil unrest and rioting. Why? Because he was a statesman. Because he understood that this wasn't just about Martin Luther King. Just like this isn't just about Ferguson. This president should not be in the Beltway delivering a speech. He needs to be in Ferguson talking about the divide that we have going on in this country. The greatest statesman speech I've ever heard came from Robert F. Kennedy because he had the courage and he had advisors that told him this is much bigger than the Martin Luther King assassination, which was huge. But the point is this, it's going to take that kind of leadership to really mend the fence here. It's certainly going to take a lot more than we're seeing coming out of Washington Beltway right now.
Do you think that the, looking at cause-effect, this hyper-militarization of our police I mean, if you go back to the Stanley Milgram experiments back in the 60s, you know, where they had the person in the lab coat say, give him a harder shock, give him a harder shock. Mm-hmm. People respond you give them authority, you give them power, and then you give them orders, and they are capable of doing anything, including murder, average people. So we've got these police who are being put in this position. They're being dressed like warriors. They're being apparently told they're warriors, given the tools of war, and then we're astounded that they act like they're in a war zone. Do you see the original cause of this being the 9/11, our hysteria around our, you know, and the stupid way George Bush responded to that by going to war instead of, you know, finding the criminals and prosecuting them? Or is it the military-industrial complex wanting to sell more of their junk, you know, now they sell it to police departments now that the war's over? Or does this go back a lot deeper and a lot farther than that?
Well, it goes back to the racial divide that has never gone away in this country, but it certainly has to do with this program 1033. Most people don't even know it, but the Pentagon takes material like helicopters and assault rifles and assault vehicles and sells them, actually donates them to these small town cops. It started over the drug war, and then after the drug war, we said we're going to arm these guys with assault vehicles and assault rifles and helicopters, and then the next thing we know, after 9/11, George Bush even pumps that up. So there's this notion, Tom, there's this notion among these police officers. Many of them have never been in active duty in places like Afghanistan and Iraq. Many of them are high school football players. They do 2 years, get their AA degree, and all of a sudden, they're put in a situation where they have to make peace in a difficult situation like this. But what we've done with program 1033 is we've armed them, and we've had them live this notion of who they are. You know, this Bruce Willis, this Arnold Schwarzenegger with the shaved head and the goatee and guns all over every appendage on their body. It's this image that's been portrayed. Blackwater, you see the image there. I mean, all I have to say is Blackwater. You can see the image. All of these characters have a need. They have a personal psychological need to live that. And so what we do is we further that, we empower that when we give them this type of ridiculous government arms that the industry, the arms industry, loves to see happening in this country right now. Very good point.